Okay, before we start, just if I could have people's attention, thank you all for coming, and just to give you a sense, we're doing this a little more formally because it's being filmed for C-SPAN as well, so people could turn off their phones. We are going to have, we have this incredible panel. We're going to start with them. Then we're going to get questions from some of you. We have an overflow room over there, and we'll get some written questions, and Mimi's going to be getting some online questions that she'll be, but we'll have plenty of time. This is going to go from 12:30 to 2, so plenty of time for your questions and conversation. And there's 3 seats up here, 2 for folks who just come in. Okay. So welcome to people in the room and to the tens of thousands of people joining through C-SPAN to the Institute for Policy Studies for this session on what we've called Election Debrief, Next Steps for the Progressive Movement. I'm John Cavanagh, director of the Institute for Policy Studies, and I'll be moderating today's session with 5 wonderful scholar activists from IPS and from allied groups. I want to just read you the paragraph that Netfa Freeman and Karen Dolan of IPS wrote when they wrote up this session 3 weeks ago, because it's still what we're doing. So I just, let me read this. It says, these are these 2 smart people. They said, the election is over. Racism, xenophobia, corporate greed, climate change, inequities, and inequality, to name just a few challenges, are still with us. So how do we maintain our collective momentum, and what are our next steps to positively transform our nation after the ballots are counted? Join our informed and dynamic panel and be a participating audience member as we discuss and interact with some of these issues and the movements struggling to transform them. We need to come together and immediately begin action steps for the next 4 years and beyond. So that's what we plan to do here for the next 90 minutes, and let me briefly introduce our 5 discussants. First, Steve Cobble, co-founder of Progressive Democrats of America, IPS Associate Fellow, someone who has led us in understanding elections going back several decades. Then, Flavia Jimenez, who is a senior attorney and project director on Immigrant Justice for the Advancement Project. Here, Alan Barber, Director of Domestic Policy at a longtime ally, the Center for Economic and Policy Research, or CEPR. Then Jonathan Hutto, who is the Prince George's County, Maryland People's Coalition Coordinator, and he's also the winner of the Letelier Moffitt Human Rights Award about a decade ago for his brave work with the group Appeal for Redress. And then finally, Phyllis Bennis, who's the director of the Institute for Policy Studies New Internationalism Project, IPS Fellow, and author most recently of Understanding ISIS and the New Global War on Terror, a primer. Before we turn to our discussants and then to you, our audience, let me start the conversation by saying this. IPS has worked with vibrant social movements for over 5 decades to advance peace, justice, and the environment in the US and abroad. And we're committed right now to being a space for creative ideas and civil dialogue in this deeply divided country and world in the days and weeks and years to come. And I just want to say our co-founder, Mark Raskin, is here, led us through much of that. His son, Jamie Raskin, was elected to the U.S. Congress yesterday. Many people in this country and in the world are right now in shock over this election. And we will need to cherish these spaces where we can come together and dialogue. And we at IPS offer you one. You can find us on the web also at ips-dc.org. And just to let you know, you all know this, IPS is a nonpartisan center of public scholarship. We don't take positions on candidates as IPS, but we are aware that among our broad progressive community, many individuals supported Jill Stein in this election, many supported Bernie Sanders, many supported Hillary Clinton, and many supported others, and we celebrate that diversity. Now, here are the rules. Each of our 5 folks will speak for just 5 minutes. I'll remind them when 5 minutes are up. They have a lot more than that to say. But we want them to say the rest of it in dialogue with all of you. and I'll field questions, and we'll be getting some also via social media. And I'll intersperse the conversation today just with a few quotes from movement allies, people who are already building for this next phase of work, things that they've sent out this morning. And I just want to start with a quote this morning, not from one of our allies, but from a woman I did not know on Huffington Post, who wrote a blog called "What Do We Tell the Children?" Just to set the tone for the conversation and for our work together, it's by Allie Michael, the director of the Race Institute for K-12 Educators on the Huffington Post. And I'll just read you her first paragraph. Here's what she wrote. Tell them first. It's funny, Flavia asked me if it was okay if she cried in this session, and of course it is, but tell them first that we will protect them. Tell them that we have democratic processes in the U.S. that make it impossible for one mean person to do too much damage. Tell them that we will protect these democratic processes, and we will use them so that Trump is unable to act on many of the false promises he made during the campaign. Tell them, second, that you will honor the outcome of the election, but that you will fight bigotry. Tell them bigotry is not a democratic value and that it will not be tolerated at your school. Tell them you stand by your Muslim families, your same-sex parent families, your gay students, your Black families, your female students, your Mexican families, your disabled students, your immigrant families, your trans students, your Native students. Tell them you won't let anyone hurt them or deport them or threaten them without having to contend with you first. Say that silence is dangerous and teach them how to speak up when something is wrong. Then teach them how to speak up, how to love one another, how to understand each other, how to solve conflicts, how to live with diverse and sometimes conflicting ideologies, and give them the skills to enter a world that doesn't know how to do this. So with that, let me start, and we'll just go right down the row here first with Steve Cobble, Progressive Democrat of America and IPS Associate Fellow.
So that was a nice night, huh? I meant to wear a black armband today, so I wouldn't have to be clear about where I stood on all this, but I guess we know why all the medical marijuana initiatives passed, because we're going to need it over the next few years. 8 years ago, I was on a panel at the old IPS in the wake of Barack Obama's first elections, and I remember telling everybody it was probably the best election of the rest of my life. And I think probably last night might qualify for the worst. And that I'm old, so that includes Ronald Reagan in 80 and Richard Nixon winning 49 states against George McGovern in 72, which was my first one. So I've been through some bad ones, but that one last night might have been the worst. And this white fright phenomenon is, I mean, this is obvious, right? It's not going away, duh. It's worldwide. And it's connected to austerity, and of course, it's connected to racism. And it's going to be with us for way too long. For the sixth time in the last seven presidential elections, the Democrats are going to win the popular vote. Hillary's going to end up winning the popular vote when the West Coast finishes voting. Nobody pointed it out last night, but she took the lead this morning, and it's going to grow. Twice in the last 5 years, the Electoral College has taken the popular vote victory away from us. And that, you know, the Supreme Court and other things obviously helped in 2000, but we do need to remember that she did win and that the rising American electorate did hold together last night, more or less. And even without Barack Obama, who, of course, is a tremendous vote getter. Hillary's going to win that election, thanks to Latinos especially. She is going to have the margin of victory last night. Unfortunately, we're missing about 20 or 30,000 votes in two or three states that were needed. So this is partly a structural defeat, combined with, as Bill Maher said last week, a slow-moving right-wing coup. We had big money pouring in from hidden donors. We had media malpractice in search of profit, voter suppression, the Electoral College, the ridiculous system of two senators per state, no matter how big the state, House and legislative, state legislature gerrymandering a poisonous, fraudulent internet, which we've lost control of. We used to be the masters of it on the progressive side, and we are not anymore. An FBI hit job, and of course, holding the Supreme Court hostage for a year for which the Republicans are not only not going to pay a price, they're going to be rewarded. So it's more obvious than ever that we need serious election reform, which Karen asked me to mention. So in my remaining minute and a half or whatever I've gotten, we need small dollar multiple public match public financing. We need instant runoff voting, yay for Maine. We need to roll back Citizens United and Buckley. We need a national popular vote so the person that wins the election actually gets to win the election. We need a constitutional right to vote. We need an end to gerrymandering, maybe with multi-member districts. We need universal automatic voter registration like Oregon pioneered last year and a few states have copied. We need to regain the public airwaves, which we've given away to privateers. We need to eliminate long lines at the polls because long lines at the polls are voter suppression. And we still need to fix the electronic machines because who knows who won Pennsylvania last night? We're never going to know. But my plan for getting all this done, since I've worked on this my entire career to amazing lack of success, is to actually get out of the way and let the millennials figure it out. So if you want to talk about that later, I will. Let me end on a thin reed of a silver lining here. The decks are now cleared for 2018 and 2020. We're in a dead straight fight right now. The fight requires a serious left leadership. It requires people like IPS. One thing about IPS, they're never going to be out of a job because there's always going to be racism, sexism, xenophobia, and climate change and nuclear catastrophe to deal with. And we need the energy and smarts of the millennials, of people like IPS. We need their ideas, progressive reform ideas. We need a hopeful vision. And the lines are clear. And the right is going to fail. We know they're going to fail. Their ideas don't make any sense. They're going to fail. Everybody's going to see it. A better world is still possible, however far away it seems this morning.
Thank you. See, Cobble. Next, Flavia Jimenez from the Advancement Project. Just back from Florida.
Yes. So spent the last couple days in Orlando. Doing voter protection, where there was quite a little bit of gerrymandering and confusion at the polls, and so I'm coming off of that. Thank you so much to IPS for inviting me here today. I just want to read to you two sentences from the press release at Advancement Project today. Talking about people of color throughout history. We have demonstrated that we will not be silent in the face of injustice and that we can build thriving local movements from coast to coast. Our movement is stronger than it's ever been. Our solidarity is deeper than ever. So, what happens to immigrants and immigration policy in this country now in the wake of this unexpected election? I would say, first and foremost, that there has never been a more important time to build multiracial movements that have a very, very clear analysis on how racism and white supremacy have a hand in policymaking and in politics in this country as it relates to immigrants. We must be very clear on this because the lack of clarity on this is actually quite shocking. And so this is one of those things that, you know, hindsight's 2020. Well, now it's a new day, right? Today is a new day. We get to hit reset and we have to do it better. The unity and the alliance building with the leaders in the African American community, the Native Americans, LGBTQ communities has never before been more important for immigrants and immigration leaders. For the next several months until January 2017, leaders in the immigration space will have to expand and create these new alliances if they not have already have begun to do that. I know that there are many organizations who have begun this journey on how to build these broad-based multiracial alliances. So just a little bit about what we know about what Donald Trump said during his candidacy on immigration. So he talked about building a wall. He talked about setting up a federal deportation force for the undocumented. In other words, emboldening and expanding the already forceful immigration deportation practice that was set up by President Obama, who has deported more individuals than any other president in the history of the United States, over 2 million people. So we expect that the Trump presidency will just continue this and expand on that. It's also very likely, very possible, that the next president will take away the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, DACA, which has helped hundreds of thousands of immigrant youth qualify for this program obtain a deferment to their deportation. That's the bad news. Okay, so what's the good news? The good news is that we have absolutely no option but to build a wall of resistance around this policy. So candidate Trump talked about building a wall, and we will build a wall of resistance. There are a number of moderate Republicans out there who understand that complete isolationism and mass deportation policies are bad policies and bad news for communities, and ultimately for them and their own communities moving forward. So how do we work with those individuals who have said out loud, I'm not comfortable with mass deportation. I don't think that it's good policy. So expanding these alliances and the solidarity well beyond what we have already done is going to take a lot of work. But there's no time for paralysis. I mean, I think that we are all feeling that way right now. But okay, let's give ourselves one day to cry and one day to have to be paralyzed. And then tomorrow, let's really start working outside of our comfort zones to see how we can build these alliances that are going to be powerful moving forward with a progressive movement, with, as I mentioned, all of these other communities. Because really the lives of millions of people are at stake, including families with children born in the United States, so they have United States citizenship. And we have to take bold, courageous steps to make sure that the rights of every single individual, including those who are undocumented, are protected in the face of this, what could be a deportation machine, an expanded deportation machine. Please follow the Advancement Project on social media, sign up for our email list as we embark in this new era in American history.
Thank you. Thank you, Flavia. Okay, turning next to Alan Barber from CEPR.
Thanks, John, and thanks, Karen and NEFTA and everyone here at IPS for having us here today for this very important and crucial forum. I think, like a lot of us, I didn't get a lot of sleep last night. You know, we expected one thing. We expected this to be a historic election. And it was, but just not in the way that we thought it would be. Because we kind of find ourselves right now at a historic moment. This can be a turning point. Our route has changed, but we still have the same ways forward that we did before. Today we're going to talk about some of those ways and the ways that they intersect. But for now, I just want to touch on the issue of income inequality. Inequality remains a challenge that we have to overcome as a nation. And even though the executive and legislative branches today aren't going to be as receptive as they were a couple of weeks ago as we'd hoped, we still saw in this election campaigns that gave voice to a populist spirit that will continue to insist on being heard. Now, much of this populism does have its roots in income inequality. For far too long, Americans have been more and more productive at work, but we haven't seen our wages grow in proportion. Today, the typical family of four pretty much makes the same thing that it did 20 years ago, about $80,000. And if we talk about the 1%, we know it's even worse. If we go back 40 years, we see that in the last 40 years, income for the top 1% has grown by 138%. For the bottom 90%, just 15%. Now let that sink in for a minute. I mean, that means that the American dream that a lot of us think of doesn't exist for a lot of people. Right now, the U.S. has fallen to number 13 in terms of social mobility amongst advanced nations. And this is important because right now we find ourselves in a moment where this election, these campaigns have given voice to populist movements at the state and local level. And that's where we have to turn our attention to. Campaigns like pushing for paid sick leave, pushing for raising the minimum wage. These are places where we saw serious gains despite the overall outcomes of this election. And I think if we continue to focus on areas like that from an economic perspective, we can maybe claw back some of the losses that we saw yesterday. And like Steve was saying, start thinking about 2020, because in a way, the campaign for 2020 starts right now. A lot of the things that come out of the next 100 days and the first 100 days of the Trump administration will set the agenda that people are running on or running against. We have to make sure that we take a moment, like Flavia said, because we deserve a moment. This hurt. But what we have to do is take that moment, re-energize ourselves, galvanize ourselves, go back to our local communities and find issues that we can organize around. And we have to find people that we can put in position to run for local office and for national office. And we will turn this around. Now, John and Karen sent us a lot of gentle, subtle reminders about keeping to the 5-minute limit. So with that, I'm going to close and I will.
Thank you so much, Alan. Yeah. Thank you. And in the conversation, we will get into some of the things at the local level and the state level, as well as the global level that we can fight on in this period. Next, Jonathan Hutto, as I mentioned, from the People's Coalition. He's the coordinator in Prince George's County, Maryland. Great to have you here, Jonathan.
Thank you, John, and thank you to the Institute for Policy Studies for hosting us and for giving us this opportunity to project forward to the nation and to the world at large. What I was planning, or what I thought I was planning to say today, was totally discarded probably at about midnight last night. And I began to think about how we got here. But when I say we, I'm speaking about those of us who were born on the margins. I'm talking about those of us who constitute the desperate, the damned, the disinherited, the disrespected, and the despised. Almost 20 years ago, when I was a student body president at Howard University, on February 17, 1998, we heard from a revolutionary, and in my opinion, the greatest and most humble revolutionary to walk that campus. His name was Kwame Ture. He was known to my mother's generation as Stokely Carmichael. And this was 9 months before he passed. And he left us with some historical dictums, and it's one that penetrated me that day and that resounds more profoundly today than it ever did. And he simply said to us numerous times that night that the struggle is eternal. That means that there is no time for us to relax and to sit back and enjoy life. He went further to tell us that this was reactionary thinking of the worst order. And so when I was thinking earlier this morning about what I could say, I thought to myself that I'm a child of the American South. We were taught in Atlanta, Georgia, my childhood. I'm an 80s kid, born 1977. We had overcome. In fact, we were taught that we were being raised and reared in the New South. But what I recall from my lessons, both oral and written, is that when the modern day civil rights movement began in 1955 in the city of Montgomery, Alabama, when a trained human rights activist by the name of Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat that day, we did not have the most votes that day. In fact, we couldn't vote. So how were we able to bring a bus system to its knees after 386 days? In 1957, in Little Rock, Arkansas, we did not have the most votes. Daisy Bates and Little Rock Nine didn't have the most votes, they couldn't vote. In 1961, when a freedom ride took off in Washington, D.C. with 13 freedom riders, the architect of that freedom ride, James Farmer, the late James Farmer, the Congress of Racial Equality, we did not have the most votes. We could not even vote. In 1963, in Birmingham, Alabama, Eugene Bull Connor represented state power. We were being crushed in Birmingham. We didn't have the most votes. We didn't even have the right to vote. But these cities, I'm saying to you, in Selma, if that was the crescendo, if that was where everything came to a climax, here we had a climax of Alabama state power smashing down on these nonviolent direct action protesters. We did not have the right to vote. We still made it to the state capitol. So what's the theme here? The theme here is that what I want to say to any activist, any organizer, anyone that desires to labor for peace, and that should be all of us, is that what the joke that went through my spine yesterday is that if we left the streets, we got to get back in the streets and organize for our survival. That's number one. Number two is that we have to have a deeper analysis of how to use the vote, which I firmly believe in. But I believe that post-1965 coming onward, too many of us started taking a nap, and then with the election of Barack Obama, sadly to say, some of us went straight to sleep. And we thought that the White House was gonna do the work for us. But the reality is that we are now in a worse situation today in the United States of America racially, and in terms of class and in terms of poverty, than we ever been, at least in my lifetime. And I'll be 40 years old in the spring. So we got to get back in the streets. The vote can be a tool and a weapon for our survival and progress. Two more points and I'll be done. What do I mean by that? How can the vote be a tool for our survival and progress? Number one, we have to reanalyze, what does it mean to win? What does winning mean? I'm reminded in San Francisco, I'm coming back to this theme of not having the most votes. Jesse Lewis Jackson Sr. didn't have the most votes in San Francisco. Some of you might have been there, I'm sure you were. He ran third out of eight candidates. But with 3.5 million votes and massive black voter registration in the South, we took the Senate in 1986. What did that mean? That meant when the veto came from Ronald Reagan against sanctions against the apartheid regime in South Africa, there was a majority in the Senate to smash that veto of Ronald Reagan. And the instrument and the tool behind that was Ron Dellums and his advocacy out of California. We can do that. That's how we use the vote as a tool and a weapon for our survival and for our progress. And lastly, I would say that we have to struggle to create some alternative power in these cities, these municipalities, what my colleague said here, for us to get the progressive reforms that we need. I'm reminded that right here in this city, one of the lasting reforms of the late Marion Barry, the first chairman of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, was to make it a law for young people to be hired to work by the city government. And that legacy still stands to this day, the Mayor's Youth Leadership Institute. So we can do it. But we got to organize, as Kwame Ture left us with, organize, organize, organize. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Jonathan. Finally, to Phyllis Bennis, who directs our new internationalism project here at the Institute for Policy Studies.
Thank you all for coming out today on this sad day, but also a day of remobilization and reconnection. I would start with the question of movements that Jonathan pointed to. I think we have to remember that movements are what change history. It's movements that can be very dangerous. The movement around the Trump candidacy was in many ways more dangerous than the candidate. There is a movement based on racism and white supremacy and misogyny, Islamophobia, xenophobia, a whole host of evils that represents in many ways why this election was so shocking to all of us. Elections are never our turf. It's never our people at this stage. They are a tactic. They are important. People have died for the right to vote. But that doesn't mean that voting is enough. Voting is one thing that we do. It's only one little part of our democracy. It's the movements that matter. I was remembering on September 12th, 2001, the day after the 9/11 attacks, the day that George Bush announced that his response to that attack would be to take the world to war. On that day, we got an email here at IPS from our great friend Oscar Olivares, an activist in Bolivia who works on water rights. And he just wrote, "We still believe that another world is possible. We are with you." And I think it was important because we have to remember that we are part of a global movement. When we talk about movements, it's not only here. Much of our work, I think, in the next period is going to be local rather than national. I think we're going to have a very hard time going to national efforts right away. It's going to start in cities and counties and maybe states. And in that context, it's going to be very important to keep in mind the planet and the people of the planet that is part of what we are fighting for. It's going to be a greater challenge than it's been before to keep the global central. But it's also part of how we're going to win. We're not the only country that has elected somebody shocking in the recent period. There's a lot of our comrades around the world who are looking at very similar elections and selections of various sorts of leaders who are self-appointed, incredibly dangerous for a whole host of reasons. We can learn from them, we can work with them, and we are part of a global movement to do that together. We have, I think, a lot that we were planning to take up when we were getting ready, those of us who work on challenging wars and occupations. We were preparing for immediate resistance, no honeymoon, no waiting, stop the wars before the escalation happens. That's what we were kind of thinking about. Today, that was going to be the day. We still have to do that. The wars are not going to not happen because Hillary Clinton's plan for a no-fly zone in Syria and a host of other things is not quite on the agenda of the White House. The wars are not going to stop right away. So we have a whole lot of those things to do that are specific to specific movements. But we have to take that up in the context of defending those among us who are the most vulnerable right now. The communities of color, immigrants, particularly Muslim immigrants, women, people of color in general, this is who LGBT communities, these are the communities that are going to be at such high risk in the next period. So all of the work that we do to stop wars, to challenge racism at its fundamental way and not just at its talked about way, all of that work is going to have to go on in the context of protecting our comrades in these communities who are going to be at even greater risk. So our resistance is going to be both defensive and offensive at the same time, defending our communities, going on the offense against these policies, against the stealing of our democracy. So when we talk about how we're going to link movements, it means that everything has to be based on our understanding of the structural realities that give rise not to white supremacy separately from misogyny, not from xenophobia separate from racism and Islamophobia, but in the ways that all of those things come together. So we're going to have to defend people against street violence, which may emerge as a greater threat than before, defend people against being deported. And when we do that, it's going to have to be in the context of also protecting and defending refugees who have come here fleeing wars. And that means we have to work to stop the wars that people are fleeing when they come here as refugees and as immigrants and as migrants, so that when we call for cities to become once again cities for sanctuary and call on our faith-based institutions, churches and synagogues and mosques, to become themselves places of refuge, places of sanctuary. That means at the same time, we have to be calling on them to demand an end to the wars that put these people at risk, and at the same time, demand that our government change our policy of not allowing people to come here and reclaim the notion that we are a nation based on not just the rule of law, but on some kind of internationalism. I would urge people, as I finish now, to read Harry Belafonte's extraordinary piece on Friday in the New York Times, just on the eve of the election, when he talked about what we have to lose in this election. And he said, what we have to lose is everything. Everything the civil rights movement fought for, everything our earlier movements have fought for. But he reminded us from the vantage point of turning 90 next month that everything can change. We come here today, and the Institute stands for 53 years now, but all of us come together recognizing that moments in history create the movements that are required to change them. We stand on the shoulders of all of those earlier movements. This time around, we will win.
Yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you very much, Phyllis. And we now have almost a full hour for your comments and thoughts. I just wanted to read one thing. IPS's tagline is Ideas and Action for Peace, Justice, and the Environment. And we haven't covered everything here, and just a bit was said about the environment. So I want to read just two sentences from May Bouvy, who's the executive director of 350.org, a dear friend and ally. Just two thoughts of hers this morning. One, this is a global movement. It is more important than ever to remember our connection with people in literally every country who are fighting the fossil fuel industry right now, many in the toughest conditions imaginable. I believe in our collective power like nothing else. So definitely a moment for more global action. And secondly, local fossil fuel resistance is taking root everywhere. Not only has the fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline spread like wildfire, but other campaigns against fracking, pipelines, and coal are too many to name. None of us are giving up or going home today. So again, the fights we can win locally and at the state level, but where we can build national resonance will be where a lot of our attention is. We're going to start with two people here. We have a program at IPS here that brings called our Next Leaders program that brings amazing young leaders to IPS. And I'll start with Chris and Nia in the back. We'll take maybe three or four comments and then get comments from the panel. Chris, do you want to go first and say who you are, if you would?
My name is Chris. I'm an absolute fellow working under Sarah Anderson's Global Economy Project. So I want to thank the panel for coming and everyone else for coming out. Definitely some trying times. I tend to be an optimist and on the bright side of things. And one of the things I wanted to address, which Mr. Barber and Mr. Cobble brought up, was one, the millennial challenge, but also fighting inequality. Inequality is a big thing in this question. Back in 2014, there were five issues that decided to increase the minimum wage. Four of them were in red states. And in this current election, there were four states, one red state, Arizona, that also voted to increase the minimum wage. I see that as a step for hope in terms of, first of all, reducing inequality, but also as a bipartisan issue. If both sides of the party agree on it, work to combat. I would like to know any of the panelists' thoughts on that, but
particularly
Mr. Barber.
Thank you,
Guy.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much to the panel for being here. And I was really happy that you brought up the Dakota, I like to call it Access Pipeline, and how today the NYPD transfer partners announced that they would begin the final rest of drilling. And what the pipeline means for sexual violence for Native American, for people and Indigenous women around that, and the man camps that creates. Also for women who are immigrants and undocumented immigrants who face sexual violence trying to immigrate to the United States. And then also, Jonathan, who are you bringing up Rosa Parks and how we watch her story over, and she was actually an NAACP investigator investigating rapes of Black women by white men. How do we get the collective power to care about the sexual violence against women of color and all women and people of different gender identities? Because the violence against trans people is also rampant. When we have someone who has been accused of sexual assault and rape leaving our nation as the president.
Thanks. Let's take one or two more. And also, just to let you know, there are people in a breakout room, and we're going to have some questions be brought in here from them. Ruth?
And say who you are.
Ruth Kaplan with the DC Public Banking Center. I'm concerned of our understanding the other. And I think the voters for Trump are the other. And I think there's a tremendous amount of fear. I don't see them as evil, frankly. I see them as really scared. I see the drug abuse. I see the suicide. I see the lack of jobs. It's not a matter of a minimum wage increasing. They don't have jobs. They don't have a hope for future. And I think that we have to somehow understand the other, the people who have voted for Trump, and not just demonize them, and figure out how to build a movement where the jobs will be created that will bring us a green revolution and bring them jobs.
Thanks, and we'll take one question from the other room. We'll have plenty of time for the next round, but go ahead, Emily.
So the question from the other room was, what are concrete ways to do direct action to delay or stop the Trump administration's agenda?
Great, okay. So let's just give you all a chance to absorb that for a second, and let's go right down the line, address any of these questions you'd like to, starting with you, Steve, and we'll go in the same order.
So I think Ruth's a better person than I am, because I don't think it's just bad economy and scared people who've lost their jobs. The driving force behind the early Trump vote actually was fairly well off and had jobs, and there seems to be a lot of meanness, a lot of racism, xenophobia, even anti-Semitism rearing its ugly head at the end of this campaign. That doesn't negate Ruth's comment about we have to understand them, and the ones that in that group who voted for Barack Obama 8 years ago were clearly not driven by racism. And so they are still theoretically reachable. And I do think we spend a lot of time on the coast mocking the trailer park crowd. And we need to stop that. And we need to get serious about talking to them. But I also think we understand that the people running this show are not them. They're not the ones who voted for Barack Obama in Ohio 8 years ago and voted for Donald Trump this time. They're the people who've been on the fringes of the nuts and the lunatics and the meanies, and I'm using nice words here because I'm on C-SPAN, for a long time, and now they've moved to the center of our politics, and they're going to be running things for a while, and it's a very dangerous moment. So I wish I had a little more of Ruth's generosity in my heart, but I do think she's right. Some of, with a good program and some empathy, some of these voters can still be brought back to our coalition. But we should also remember, our coalition is technically bigger than theirs, even right now. It just structurally didn't fit the ridiculous contours of American political projects. Again, for the second time in 5 years, we got robbed that way.
Thank you. Flavia.
So I just want to address the issue of sexual violence, because I think it's a really important one. We see of the Central American refugees coming to our border since 2014, almost 100% of the children have faced sexual abuse. So this is something that is clearly an issue, and I don't have an answer for you about how you address this. I do think, though, that making space and creating space for individuals, particularly women, to raise their voices around these kinds of issues, I think has to be part of this new way of being able to address the issues. And I think also in our ability to support the families that are in fact migrating to the United States, particularly, because that's my area of expertise, being able to address this issue of qualifying for asylum and providing some sort of refugee status. I understand it's going to be a very, very uphill battle, but the sanctuary cities in the 1980s offer us at least a way to think through structural local solutions to this problem. So how do we engage interfaith in an interfaith dialogue and actually open up the doors of our faith institutions as sanctuaries to these families.
Okay, yeah, let me just take a crack at two of these as we go down. First, just on the issue of immigration, so central, and I will say many of our allies raising up the issue that our number one priority today is to reach out to the millions under threat of deportation and show our solidarity. I just want to say, 2 months ago in this room, we had allies talking about what we could do if Trump were elected. And one of our allies who is here, Saket Soni, who runs the New Orleans Worker Center for Racial Justice, said, hey, we'll have to get all movements to, this was when Donald Trump was so focused on building the wall. And he said, we will have to get all of our movements to come together and get 100,000 people to march to the border and prevent the wall from being built. And we talked about that for a half an hour and we said, okay, we will do that. Now that would require, back to Flavia's earlier point, a different coming together of movements. And so I think, just want to challenge us all to reimagine the possible, reimagine the coalitions we will need to build to be able to stop the worst from happening. And then just the other thing, to several of you have raised, and Chris just did, the issue of local initiatives. We at IPS, and Karen Dolan and Phyllis Bennis and others of you participated in this, we built a coalition called Cities for Peace and worked with over 350 cities who passed resolutions against the war. Then we brought mayors and city council people to Washington to raise up that action. So local actions, but that were given national prominence. Can we do that around something related to refugees and the issue of deportation? Are there city council resolutions? And Phyllis has been thinking about this, so when we get to her, she can pick up on it. But a Cities for Peace and Refuge that is lifting up protection of and bringing in refugees with a statement of a different kind of foreign policy. Another of our colleagues here, Chris and Sarah Anderson, have been working with the Portland City Council on a resolution that will likely pass in early December that will tax companies more in Portland that have more than a 100-to-1 ratio of CEO pay to worker pay. Again, we know that that is popular. Could we get 200 cities to do that and use that to build pressure directly on the companies? Win at the levels where we can win while we try to stop the worst at the national level. Alan.
I think I'm going to try and tackle Brian's question regarding the minimum wage and why raising the wage is important. Now, raising the wage isn't a cure-all, of course, we all know that, but it is an important tool for us to employ. Just for background, if we look at the current federal minimum wage, right now at $7.25, that's basically the same as it was in 1968. That doesn't equate to a livable wage for people today. And not having a livable wage means that it's much more difficult for them to engage in civic society. It's harder for them to take time from work to go to the polls and vote. And that might be endemic of this messed up system of voting that we have right now, but it's still problematic. And the thing, and then we can bring in millennials to this equation by noting that millennials recognize this and were crucial in pushing for raising the minimum wage. Right now we have, with the four states that just passed ballot initiatives in favor of raising the wage, we have 22 states that now want to raise the wage higher than the federal minimum wage by 2020. That wouldn't have been possible without the energy of millennials who were there out in the streets, out pushing the boundaries, out making sure that people realized that this was a problem that we could come together and solve. And it's important because right now our economy is suffering from a serious lack of demand. And by raising the wage, we can create demand. That demand grows the economy. That economic growth creates jobs. And that's how raising the wage plays into being a tool that helps the economy writ large and fights economic inequality. Again, it's not a cure-all, but it is one crucial piece of the puzzle.
Thank you. That's Alan Barber of CEPR, and now to Jonathan Hutto.
Looking at the last question that was asked in terms of direct action that is needed to stop the Trump agenda. What I was saying to myself in my mind is that from where I sit and from where I organize, that the internal is primary. What do I mean by that? I live in a majority Democratic Party state. The state of Maryland was not your battleground state last night. It was called pretty early. And I definitely live in a majority Democratic county, Prince George's County, roughly 70% African-American, which is certainly Hillary country. But within that situation, as progressives, we got a battle that's taking place. For 15 years, 15 years plus for me, we've been laboring and struggling to get reform to what's known as the Law Enforcement Officers Bill of Rights in the state of Maryland. This is a law that codifies, from our perspective, the blue wall of silence. And up to last year, officers, when they were involved in an act of excessive force, were given up to 10 days that they were not questioned by anyone. Okay, and so from an activist standpoint, you can see how we look at that. It was not until the rebellion that took place in Baltimore in the aftermath of Freddie Gray's tragedy of Freddie Gray, that we even got movement within the state legislature on that law. And even though we got a couple bills passed, those numerous bills, as a young activist in the room from Leaders of a Beautiful Struggle out of Baltimore, they labored tirelessly. We got two bills passed, one that passed the principle of citizens being on internal police trial boards. But we see right now in Prince George's County nullification being practiced, law not being implemented because fraternal order police, both in Prince George's County and throughout the nation, fights to keep transparency and accountability out of the system. So we're still in a battle right now as we speak. Paid sick leave. I live in a county that's majority Democratic where the county council, majority African American, they rejected paid sick leave. Progressive Maryland lobbied and fought for it. The county council rejected it. I live in a county where the school board, half of which, including the chair, is appointed directly by the county executive, including the superintendent. And we just lost a Head Start grant of $6.4 million because of alleged abuses in the school system. So I come from the perspective, we got a judge yesterday, Judge Herman C. Dawson. New York Times wrote an expose in December 2014. Judge Dawson just won re-election yesterday. It was four spots, five actual people running for circuit, seven judges. Juvenile judges. He was one of the four that won. He is documented as using mass incarceration as a weapon against our young people when they appear in his courtrooms. New York Times documented this. So I come from the perspective that although we have to have that struggle externally, we got to fight with those who claim to be our allies, with those who actually claim to represent us. We got to battle internally to hold those folks accountable. Otherwise, we're not going to be able to take back the country in any sort of progressive way. So I'm going back home to Prince George to organize.
Yeah, Phyllis Bennis.
I wanted to comment on the question about Trump voters and the issue of fear. I think it is very important. I also think I absolutely agree with Steve that there is not just a thread, but a core of racism that runs through it. I think it's not that every individual who voted for Trump is a stone cold racist, but in the absence of a fully articulated alternative cultural approach to how to deal with the very real challenges that people face in areas where jobs have disappeared, where money is just not available, where their options have disappeared, we do see this acceptance of racist scapegoating as the basis for turning to Trump. So we have to deal with it both understanding what drives people to look for that kind of a model, but recognizing that the model they have chosen is fundamentally racist at its core, and all these other things, misogynistic and Islamophobic and everything else. But I wanted to say one other thing that about what John raised about this idea of focusing at least a part of our work on areas where we can actually gain some traction. I don't want to say victories because I don't know that we're there yet. But in terms of changing the discourse, changing public discourse Some of that happens at the national level, but a lot more of it happens at the local level, cities and counties and states. So this idea of creating a new campaign, somewhat based on our old campaign during the Iraq War, Cities for Peace, the idea of mobilizing cities to work for some version of either a city council resolution, a mayor's proclamation, it could take a number of forms. The key thing is linking two fundamental challenges that we face. One is defending the rights, not just the existence, but the rights of refugees, the rights to gain refuge internationally under international law, the rights of people in our communities to welcome refugees and not have them be treated as you know, third class people who have to be just grudgingly admitted in the tiniest numbers. Getting away from the idea that we should, for example, be claiming that it's a great, something, a point of pride to say that the US has taken in 10,000 refugees in an entire year. When, if you look at last summer, Germany alone was taking in 20,000 a day. So this notion really has to be challenged. But we're not just talking about the rights of refugees, we're also talking about challenging the US policies that have been so fundamental in creating the wars and perpetuating the wars that create the refugees. So linking the rights of refugees and the welcoming of refugees and protection of immigrants in that context, not only refugees, but other immigrants as well, with the need to challenge the war drive. It's a big set of issues, but it's something that I think makes a lot of sense for a lot of people because it answers kind of two sets of things. So a campaign of Cities for Peace and Refuge, or some other name, something like that, that would link people around the country that are working on this in their local areas, begins to have national impact when you look at how the discourse on these questions gets changed. Right now, the discourse about refugees is they are all terrible. They are all a threat. They are all terrorists. They have to be super vetted. The vetting takes up to 3 years for US residency without any rights. We have to get past that. We have to be welcoming and saying, you know, the old saying on the Statue of Liberty, give me your tired, your poor, doesn't say, you know, only if they're rich and have been vetted and no men, it can only be women. And, you know, we have to get past that. At the same time, we have to be taking responsibility for what our government, using our tax money to buy weapons produced in our country, right, are doing to perpetuate these wars. So it's that combination of things that I think we're going to be able to take on whoever is in the White House.
Thanks. Okay, we'll open it back up again. You had your hand up before in the blue shirt. There's quite a few of you. So if you could keep just your thoughts short, we'll take several and then get a set of reactions. Okay, well, why don't you read that first, then we'll go to the blue shirt, and then we'll move our way around. You have two blue shirts here. Sorry. Mandisa.
Yes, I'm Mandisa Rofinia from IPS. I'm bringing some questions from our folks who are watching at home live stream from Twitter and from our site. We have Dory Smith first. She asks, how can we help those who will not be able to get health care without Obamacare? And we really wanted to point that question to Alan Barber. And we also have Gabo who says, I see the fight against the surveillance state as being very key in the way that this went. What are concrete next steps?
Thank you. We'll start with a light blue shirt and then go to the dark, okay?
I'm Ben Perkins. One of the things that I was watching really closely last night is I'm from Southern New Hampshire, Hillsborough County, which was projected to go Clinton by quite a bit, and I think went Clinton by about half a point. And this is not an area where the jobs have been fleeing. This is relatively affluent, a lot of tech jobs. And I was, you know, I kept thinking, but my grandmother, who's from the area, she's passed away now, but she was born in 1919, and she would absolutely have been a Trump voter. But I think that, but the reason for that is not, you know, we talked about this sort of this racist line, and like she, from Southern New Hampshire, probably had never had to deal with anyone of color, probably never had to deal with anyone that wasn't white, middle-class Protestant. And I think, but you can, I mean, she's a gentle soul, great woman, and you can reach these people to some extent. And I think that that's, it was really a sort of a tragedy that a lot of swaths of the country were sort of written off. It's like, we're not going to be able to get traction to these people, let's ignore them. And that sort of came around to really cause a lot of issues last night. So I'm wondering how we can sort of address that.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Yeah, I'm Joe Auslander, and actually connected with the last question. I'm wondering, well, we've heard these excellent presentations of how to move forward, which is very important. But we might step back and think, did we do anything wrong in the campaign? And if so, what was it? What could we have done differently. Ms. Bennis did address that a little bit. And related to that, maybe, is there a future for the movement around Bernie Sanders?
Thank you very much. You two have had your hands up for a long time. Diane first, and then Ron.
Diane Perlman, School for Conflict Analysis and Resolution, George Mason, and also a psychologist. Well, first I want to point out that this happened on the 9th of November, which is the anniversary of Kristallnacht, which is the shattering of the glass, and we didn't shatter the right glass, and the falling down of the Berlin Wall, and we're talking about coming up with a wall now, so there's an imagery of opposites, and it's also the opposite of 9, 11, 11, 9, or whatever that's worth. But I wanted to talk about also the vulnerability of a category of people who love Trump to being manipulated. And I agree with Steve that there's a very small percentage that are unreachable, but there's also an issue of envy and humiliation and feeling inferior to elites. And that we can't, you know, we have to be careful not to insult or to humiliate, not that it's fun and screamers like that. But that, you know, we have to find ways to satisfy some of their deeper needs and core issues of identity that Trump appealed to and made them feel better about themselves. And some of the racism is associated with, you know, Black people being smarter and, you know, feeling left out, being on the other side of the digital divide. And I think in our culture, yeah, I understand that, say, in Europe, there's more dignity for people who are poor, that who are not academically inclined. So we have to dignify, find ways to reach these people to make them, help them be less vulnerable to manipulation.
Thank you very much. Ron.
I'm Ron Fisher. My website is peoplenow.org. You can find everything there I'm going to talk about. What I'd like to talk about quickly, and I have one quick question, is the United Nations has issued 169 targets and 17 SDGs. That's all on my website. And these answer all the questions, all these problems I've heard today. And each one of these problems, I have what is called a target action plan. I was a Duke subordinate in the Navy. You got to take action. So these are target action plans. There's one on election. But the main one I want to talk about is the one from Jonathan Phyllis. Phyllis is correct. We really do need to get all this information we need in one place we're working on. And the movements are really important. So this TAP target action plan is to organize everything, everybody, by 9-digit zip codes. I did this in an election, organized the zip code, and we won 2-1. So precinct. You organize by 9 digits. And you gotta hug your person with a 9-digit, you got food with a set of 9 digits, you give food to it. But the goals cover everything. I've got one quick question. I know about 5 or 6 things we can do about Trump. I'd like to hear any ideas about the hardest thing has been to get people to read and look at these. It bores everybody to tears, but please tell me how I get, what you would do. I know 3 or 4, and I'll be happy to talk. I got a tap on elections or on immigration.
Okay, thank you, John. Sorry, down here, and then we'll go back here.
Hello, everyone. I'm Hila Dad with the Climate Justice Alliance. This panel's given me life, and I agree with this gentleman, we need to take action. I'd love for us to discuss the issue of climate change, because I didn't hear it come up much in the panel, and I think it's fundamental, and it is a cross-sectoral discussion that needs to be addressed soon. Our international colleagues are working with our national colleagues on the Paris Agreement right now as we speak. You know, folks are organizing, as we've heard before, with indigenous communities. You know, if something's gonna give us hope, 500 years of resistance is gonna give us hope. And so we're putting out a call, Climate Justice Alliance, to folks to join us in Thanksgiving week with our communities, Sandy Rock, IEN, and others, to come out and show your real support, to you know, really look at what 500 years of resistance is and how we address a just transition framework for this work. Because, you know, using our kind of terminology, what we need is a just transition framework for our communities. Ending fossil fuels and the use of fossil fuels is important. Limiting greenhouse gas emissions is important. Providing solutions to our communities that are most vulnerable, I think, is number one right there.
Thank you, Jan. That's the Climate Justice Alliance. And we're going to take more here because you all have a lot to say, and then we'll have a chance for everyone here to respond to what they've heard. But the young gentleman in the back.
Thank you. My name is Lawrence Grant Free. I'm a plaintiff of people struggling in Baltimore. We work with Johnson on some statewide legislation there. We work around policing reform, but I'll try to narrow my question to a larger way of viewing the election. So I guess my question is, what happens to this conversation if we assume that the white folks who voted for Trump and the black folks who didn't show up were both making rational decisions, as opposed to irrational decisions? So I think that's a moment where we lose some focus. White folks, whether it's Derek Bell or Demi talking about the wages of whiteness. And that's a very material thing that folks are consuming. So they're not voting against the economic self-interest if the elite have not been able to correctly interpret the self-interest in these communities. I think some of the data is beginning to show that out, where across economic, it's more about race in terms of some of the early election data. But last thing I'll say is that in terms of the black votes, in terms of why some of those black voters don't turn out, if you look at some of the history of these urban communities, like Buddy Gray's communities, so-called infrastructure investment has not been good for them in terms of what the highways have done. and even if you look at San Francisco specifically, where Buddy Gray lived, where we've done some work, that was a site for Clinton's empowerment zone. Hundreds of millions of dollars have come into that community. And the folks who benefited left the community, and then they brought in increased policing to secure their investment. And so what happens if the Democratic Party owns its elitism for both the white and the black?
Thank you very much. Sorry, Emily, did you have something for me in the next room?
This person from the next room is wondering about whether we should work within the two-party system or outside them and how. And then my question for myself comes from a place of feeling real and dramatic fear for my queer and trans family. And I love the idea of what you've been talking about in terms of sanctuary cities, and I'm wondering if that's an idea we could apply to queer and trans youth. Or what other ideas you have in general for, I'm hearing about protection and defense, and that's resonating with me a lot. I'd love to hear you speaking about how we can protect our community.
Thanks so much. And by the way, we obviously aren't going to, answer everything, but we want to get the ideas and thoughts out here. And as I said at the beginning, IPS is really dedicated to being a space. I think also the groups of the folks that are here, also a space where we're going to have a lot of conversation over in the days and weeks to come. There were like three more here that let's take. The gentleman there, and then Steve.
Yeah, my comment is kind of piggybacking off of a comment on the other and it has to do, everybody's talking about who voted for Trump and who voted for Trump. But in the African community, we don't take seriously those people who see no positive impact of the Democrats or the Republican Party, and who absent themselves from this, which appears to us to be a farce, for a very long time. Even our own so-called political leaders get on the radio and talk about how we are apathetic and we're helping Trump get in power. But really, our political analysis is telling us that both the Democrats and the Republicans are two sides of the same coin that have never served our interests, and that we have to begin to look at a different kinds of politics, which brings me to my question for the panel. Perhaps it is really time to start looking at some kind of coalition party that can be a viable third party option to both the Republicans and the Democrats, that is based on the sincere and real interest of the exploited and oppressed people in this nation. We are not going to put our life and our well-being and our future in the hands of Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump. And we really weren't that disappointed at last night's results, because it's pretty much the same thing that won along.
Steve Dubb with the Democracy Clubbers. I guess what I want to ask about are building, what can be done to build up economic institutions. So just to give a quick example of what I mean, in Michigan became a right to work state in 2014. If that hadn't happened, that's pretty much likely to be a blue state instead of a red state, particularly given the margin of victory, right? And so these, you know, whether it's worker centers, unions, new cooperative development, you know, what can be done in terms of organizing, not just for elections, but for economic self-sufficiency and institutions that will, you know, allow for, you know, a stronger progressive movement in 2020.
Thank you very much. So we'll take two more, the woman with the scarf and the gentleman over here, and then we'll come back to our panel.
Good afternoon, and thank you everyone for being here. My name is Michelle Roberts, National Co-Coordinator with the Environmental Justice Health Alliance. We would be remiss if we did not look at the whole trajectory that goes back from racism, the exploitation of minerals, and all of these other things from the natural world, if you will, as Angela referred to with our indigenous brothers and sisters holding it down, with the failed debacle of our chemical policies from our enviro groups to the disconnection of that of the war and the military complex as it relates to that of oil, gas, and chemical regimes, hence the issue of the climate crisis, hence the issues of the climate injustice, hence the forced migration. Unless we look at this in a totality, whereby which grassroots are honestly leading from the bottom up, we must organize, strategize with those most impacted, but they're not in this room, are they? And we continue to have these discussions, no disrespect to all of our wonderful brothers and sisters in here, but this type of paradigm must even begin to shift. So this is where the earth is rumbling right now for us all to figure out. And I want to say this is no different for us in Black and Brown America today than it was yesterday or tomorrow. But I tell you what, in faith and peace, we've come this far by faith, and faith will lead us on. And I'm with all of you for wanting to organize in a faith-filled, principled justice way so that we see that everybody's voice is right there, front and center, and nobody is disassociated from the other.
That's all I got to say. Thanks for the thank you. Okay. Thanks very much. I see this as a golden opportunity if people would look at it. First of all, I just want to say I voted for Joe Stein. I live in D.C. I first was able to vote in 1976, and I voted for Jimmy Carter. I have not voted for Republican or Democrat since then, and because I got smart. One of the things I think that is the opportunity of this is that the electorate did the great service to the Democratic Party by eliminating the Clintons out of its you know, structure, right? So that vacuum, hopefully, that exists with them gone, should be a top priority of what you're going to do to fill it. Because there's only two things you're going to do, as been told. You can create a separate political movement, a separate political party, or you can do like what the Tea Party did. You can take over this vessel and drive it the way you want to drive. Okay, you have not seen do that yet, but with Elizabeth Warren looming and the Bernieites looming, it could be done if you but sat down and made it happen. But one of the things that absolutely needs to be done is that the elitism of the neoliberal left, progressive so-called white movement have to get off their horse, because when we have really bona fide progressive people like Cynthia McKinney in 2008, when she ran as the presidential candidate of the Green Party, Cynthia McKinney had a 10-year, five-term record as a House member of the Georgia delegation, and she was dissed by probably everybody in this world and never given a thread of legitimacy as being the presidential candidate of the Green Party. Okay, and she had more bona fides than Barack Obama at the time. So my question is, will this golden opportunity be used to create, like people say, a really viable alternative that actually puts the priorities of
black people, poor people, not in some titular position, but have the people like the system, other people come out and lead this movement and have white progressives actually take their leadership.
Thank you. Okay, so we've got about 15 minutes left here, and there's five of you. So if you could keep your comments to 2 or 3 minutes and pick one or two of the ones that you feel like you want to take on, starting with Steve Cobble.
So I helped draft Bernie to run, so I suppose I should weigh in on the Bernie question and this question of third party. It seems to me that in the last year and a half, we've conducted two major experiments, both of which argue against trying to do a third party from the top down, which is that Bernie, who had never been a Democrat, entered the Democratic Party, generated huge enthusiasm, visibility for his issues, raised $250 million, won 23 states, and Jill Stein running top down green, and this is not to compare Bernie and Jill's moral authority, is to compare tactically what happened. She was ignored and she got 1% of the vote. And so, and simultaneously, we see the alt-right taking over the other major party in this country and elevating themselves to positions of power and danger in front of our eyes. And it strikes me that they didn't form the Breitbart Party. They used Donald Trump to take power. And that seems to me to be a pretty clear illustration. The Bernie illustration and the Trump illustration both lead us to the same conclusion, which is that the Democratic Party, for better or worse, until you build something from the ground up, which is not visible to me around the country, then the Democratic Party is our vehicle. And I do think that most of the people we care about are going to regret that Chuck Schumer's not the majority leader, even though he's a Wall Street senator, and Hillary Clinton, who's a Wall Street president or would have been, they're going to regret that they're not in office in power come January. I feel fairly safe in making that prediction, even though we would have been fighting with them, as Flavia said, starting tomorrow. And so I'm glad to continue that conversation because I know that's a deep-seated argument that's been going on forever with us, including with myself. But I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Steve. Yeah, Flavia.
So I want to say that there have been a couple comments about, well, would have made no difference either way, Trump or Clinton. But I just want to say that for the 11 million undocumented immigrants in this country, and the hundreds of thousands of immigrants who will lose their temporary protection on deportation, this is a very real fear. So it does in fact make a very real difference to them who is in the White House. And that's just a matter of fact. That's not my opinion. We are about creating power from the ground up, an advancement project. And so our job is really to support the impacted communities, communities of color, on a variety of issues, including education, immigration, and voting. There's been a lot of conversation about voting, but I would say that there's a, in terms of building and creating these alliances, the right to vote is something that we really do should get behind, because it almost feels to me like that's at the core of so many of the issues that we're talking about, is fundamentally the right to vote in this country and our ability to create these democratic infrastructures at the local, state, and federal level.
Thanks. Yeah, a couple of quick points from my vantage point here at the Institute for Policy Studies. One first on the Trump voters. People here have, and our friend from New Hampshire talked about this as well, have referred to the fact that we shouldn't put them all in one big camp or category. There's some who are part of a dangerous militia movement in this country that is racist and xenophobic, and there are others who perhaps can be reached. I simply want to give an invitation to you all. We have a project at IPS which reaches out to Trump voters this way. We send five op-eds
a week to the 1,700 small circulation papers in this country, most of them in rural areas, many of them in red and blue and purple states, and we are reaching out to people who don't agree with us. It challenges us to write in a way that reaches out. And if any of you would like to learn more about it, take part in it, let me know. And just the other point, many of these comments have had to do with movements, almost all of them, which is fabulous. I want to say from our standpoint, some of our core allies here, we share an office with the National Domestic Workers Alliance, organizing nannies and caregivers and domestic workers. We have a deep alliance with a group called People's Action. All of them are building movements to challenge for power. And almost all of them have both nonprofits and C4s that are running people for office. And I simply want to say, just read one paragraph from Leanne Hall and George Gale, the co-directors of People's Action. They remind us, they say, even in this moment of darkness, there are victories that give us hope. In Nevada, we elected the first Latina U.S. Senator last night, Catherine Cortez Masto. In Washington State, we elected a longtime community champion and to the House of Representatives, a friend of many of us in this room, Pramila Jayapal. In Minnesota, we elected Ilhan Omar, our first Somali-American immigrant to the state assembly. And in Arizona, we removed one of the most vicious anti-immigrant sheriffs in the history of our country, George Arpaio. And all of these because of movements. So I think we all have a strong instinct. It's partly the self-criticism some of you mentioned from the first 2 years of Barack Obama. As Jonathan said, we some people went to sleep. We know now, we were even prepared if Hillary Clinton was president, we knew that wins would come from movement building allies. And there's some amazing ones growing. People's Action has affiliates, over 50 affiliates in 32 states. They are building power. It's not gonna be quick, but none of the things that we've won and that people here have described have been quick. We invite you to join us. Alan.
Really quickly, I'll address the question that was posed to me, and unfortunately, it's the one with the worst answer of all. If the ACA does get repealed, people who were given health care, they won't have it anymore. And that's something that we've been, you know, we've had people working towards health care for more people here in this country for years. And if it were to be repealed, there really isn't anything that could take its place. I mean, even at CEPR, we had pivoted to thinking about what we can do to get a public option at the state level to advance it forward. But this is unfortunately one of the darkest answers that you'll hear on this stage today. What I can say is it gets back to the movement issue that we've all been talking about. If we continue to organize, if we continue to fight, if we continue to demonstrate that in states where the exchanges are still there, that you can't just take away health insurance from people. I mean, the Republicans in red states are going to realize that their constituents got covers. They have health care. Even though they hate Obamacare, they do like the fact that they can go to the doctor with a pre-existing condition. I mean, so we have to continue to build those movements, and I'm going to use that to pivot to the other question about economic institutions. That's how we build economic institutions too. We organize. There's models to have this happen at the state level. If you look at, say, Montana has a singular law. It's unique in the United States. This law says that after 1 year, there's no at-will employment. That means that after 1 year, you can't be fired just arbitrarily. If you start organizing a union, you can't be fired arbitrarily. If for whatever reason your employer just decides to kick you to the curb, you can't be fired for no reason. That's the sort of thing that we can, that if we have our movements come together, our coalitions coalesce with millennials, with activists who've been out there fighting the fight, we can move to put initiatives like that on the ballot all across the U.S. And that's the sort of thing that can build those economic institutions. And working in conjunction, then we can maybe get to a point where we don't have to worry about people losing their health care because we repeal the ACA. Hopefully we can get to that point where we can push back on it and not let things like that happen. I think my 3 minutes is up. Jonathan, all you.
Thank you. Jonathan Hutto.
Very, very quickly, from where I stand, I'm going to address two issues. The first issue of whether or not we should work in the two-party system or not, I look at that question more as a tactic and a strategy and not as a principle. So I don't work within the Democratic Party based on principle. Like, I don't look at that as that's the sole principle way for us to organize. But I do see it potentially, I've seen at the local level, be an efficient tactic and strategy if we're movement centered and those people that represent us are based in our movement. So when in terms of the two shots that we've had at this, in the 1980s, I thought the Rainbow Coalition really represented a potential opportunity for us. And I thought Reverend Jackson did a marvelous job, but what did the concession speech in 84 get us? What it got us was the creation of the Democratic Leadership Council. Some of those persons were the wife of one who was one of the principal creators of that, Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, Democrats for the death penalty, for example, Democrats for trade agreements. This was the DLC, okay? What did the concession in 1988 from Jesse get us? It got us George H. Bush. And what did the concession from Bernie get us? There's a reason why we're talking to Trump voters. Well, that was in large part Bernie's base, wasn't it? I mean, Bernie won the state of Michigan. Hillary lost the state of Michigan. So what did the concession get us from Bernie? What if there wasn't a concession? Let's dream for a minute. What if there wasn't a concession from Bernie? What if Bernie went all the way? What if? And then lastly, in terms of our indigenous brothers and sisters in Standing Rock, that movement is the moral challenge of our day. President Barack Obama still has a few minutes left in office. We should hold him accountable. He said there's going to be some reform to the 1033 program. There's tanks and military equipment out there right now as we speak. We should still hold him accountable to stay true to what he said coming out of Ferguson. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Finally, Phyllis Bennis from IPS.
Just very quickly, what he said. On the question of seeing voting and parties in a very tactical and once in a while strategic way, but never as a question of principle. I think that it's very important that we see these things in the context of inside and outside organizing. Sometimes one is more important, sometimes the other is more important. We can never lose sight of two diametrically opposite things. One is, it's our movements that change history. And two, we have to engage with power where it is. Mm-hmm. That's often in political parties, not always, but if we're going to engage with them, that's how we have to do it. But I think that we have to do that understanding that the mainstream parties have never and will never represent the interests of people of color, of impoverished communities, of indigenous people, of the earth. That's not where it happens. They don't represent those interests. But that doesn't mean, in my view, that there's no difference between parties or between candidates at different times. It's different at different times. But to say that the threats to our whole movement and our ability to resist, which we now face from a Trump administration in a way that we did not face with Clinton, that's a big difference. It's not to say that Hillary Clinton was our friend, God forbid. She was certainly not, and we were planning protests on the day of if she got arrested. I really did not mean to say that she got elected. There would be protests at the White House. But there is a huge difference between whether we can have a protest at the White House and whether we are threatened with losing the right to protest in the streets in front of the White House. So I think that it is important that we recognize both the need for inside and outside strategies, and that we engage with power in a serious way, and that we remember our country has gone through these struggles before. We do have the McCarthy period, and we survived. We do have the overthrow of the first Reconstruction. It was a huge price that was paid for African Americans, an enormous price that was paid, but it survived. Movements survived, and the civil rights movement came out of that. So it's not to say that because we've had a defeat, that our movements are gone. Our movements continue. We still stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before.
Thank you, Phyllis. Just in closing, a couple things. One, I want to share a note just from another movement ally that just came in, Saru Jayaraman, the head of the Restaurant Opportunity Center, the restaurant workers. They did win one fair wage, getting rid of the tip minimum wage in Maine. And she asked that, for many of you in this room are in D.C., she had people at all the polling places signing up people for a ballot initiative to get rid of the tip minimum wage in 2 years here on the DC ballot. So another really important fight. I want to simply say, I want to remind you all, because each of these people come from institutions that you should get to know better. So, and you should visit their site. So Steve Cobble with both IPS and the Progressive Democrats of America, Flavia Jimenez with the Advancement Project, Alan Barber with CEPR, or the Center for Economic and Policy Research, Jonathan Hutto with the Prince George's County Maryland People's Coalition, and Phyllis Bennis from IPS. I do want to say our followers on social media have been flooding us with more questions and concerns to share with us, and we're sorry we couldn't get to them all, but glad we got to some of them in this short time together. It's clear you really want to continue this conversation. So please stay in touch with us, and we'll plan more of these discussions. Thank you all for coming, and thank you to the panel.
Thank you, IPS. Thank you, guys.